Okay, when we talk about covenants, covenants are made by the shedding of blood, and we're talking about just having faith and being obedient. Watch what's happening in Genesis 12, chapter verse 1. And Yahuwah has said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, into a land that I will show thee. Anybody knows what's going on right here? Excuse me? Absolutely. So he's setting him apart. And to be set apart is to be what? Is to be Kodesh. Now watch what's happening here in Genesis, the 12th chapter, verse 1. We have a situation, as you already know, Morey, is that our people get comfortable. They get very, very comfortable. So in order for me to have a relationship with you, I need to take you out of your element where you're so comfortable at. That's the only way that I can commune with you to get your attention if I bring you out of your comfort zone. Israel likes to be comfortable. You like to be comfortable. And this is what the Christian church teach. But you're going to have to remember, there is something that you did. You made a covenant with the Father. You broke the laws. We've been scattered amongst the four corners of the earth. What I need to do now is get your undivided attention. So he's not going to bring Abraham out of his comfort zone so now I can have a relationship with him. Father is trying very, very hard to have a relationship with you. And the guidelines to having a relationship with you is that you must follow again Torah. No matter what. There can be no relationship without Torah. It's impossible. Genesis, the 22nd chapter. So we see now that Abraham was very obedient. He did exactly what the father asked him to do. He wanted to have this set apart, this Kodesh or Kadesh relationship with the father. And so in order for him to do that, he had to be taken out of his comfort zone. Genesis 22. Let's see how Abram begins to grow in Torah. In following the instructions of the Father and the will of the Father. So first and foremost, above anything, in all things, the will of the Father must be done. And it came to pass, after these things, that Yahuwah did tempt. We're going to keep everything, he tested. Just the way that the Father is going to test every single individual in this congregation. I guarantee you, you have to be tested to know whether or not you can actually uphold your end of the bargain because you made a promise. The scripture tells us that he's going to bring two-thirds or one-third through the fire, and he's going to refine you as silver is refined. So you have to go through the test. Mm-hmm. How do you know that you have 24 karat gold? You fold an acid up there and see how the gold reacts. Mm-hmm. To the acid or the abuse that you're going to now put it to know whether or not it's 24 carats.
That's right.
Every single thing has to be tested. Can your car go 100 miles per hour? Let's test it. Huh? Do you love the Father? I'm going to test you. Do you love the Isha? You're going to be tested. Does the Isha love you? She's going to be tested. And the rules that's going to be used to test her, it goes back again to Torah. And in this test, not everybody's going to make it. Sad to say, not everybody's going to make it. Mommy, brother, father, sister, wife, you might have been with 15, 20, 30 years. If this is not the center of attention, you're going to have problems. Now again, this is not me speaking. This is what the scriptures is saying. Now, let's go look at obedience. And it came to pass that after these things that Yahuwah did test Abraham and said unto him, Abram. And he said, Behold, here I am. And he said, Watch this. Take thy son, thy only son, Ishak, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I should tell thee. So he wanted Abraham to do what we call a olah, which is a burnt offering, a sweet savior to Yahuwah. This is what was asked of Abram. Without going through the whole story, was Abraham obedient to the Father? Right, so, okay, exactly, okay, hallelujah. Right, so, doesn't matter, it'll be good. So, my argument, or the picture that I'm trying to draw here, is that there should be nothing that the Father asks you to do that you should be willing to do. I also want it documented here, okay, because we have the camera running, right? I didn't tell nobody to go out and kill the children. That's not the message here. What we're trying to get here is to teach you now that obedience is the key to have this relationship. And if we can get that proper understanding, the closer we'll get in proper alignment with the Father, because you don't want it said at the end of the day that the groom is saying that, listen, I never knew you because you didn't follow Torah. I need for you now to follow instructions. And Abraham, as we know, believed in the resurrection. Let's go to the book of Exodus, the 24th chapter. Exodus 24th chapter, the 24th chapter, read verses 12 and 13. And Yahuwah said unto Moshe, Come up to me in the mountain and be there, and I will give thee tables of stone. And I will give thee tables of stone, and a law, and commandments, which I have written, that thou mayest teach them. Read it again. And Yahuwah said unto Moshe, Come up unto me into the mountain, unto the mount, and be there. And I will give thee tables of stone, and a law, and commandments, which I have written, that thou mayest teach them. Verse 13. And Moses rose up, and his minister, Yahusha, or Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of Yahuwah. Now, hold that, and now we want to go to Exodus, the 34th chapter. Exodus, the 34th chapter. Let's see here. I'm gonna go at 28. And he said, and he was there with Yahuwah 40 days and 40 nights, and he did eat bread. Nor drink water. And he wrote upon the tablets the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. And it came to pass when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of stone. I'm missing something here. Excuse me. I jumped ahead. Excuse me. 34 verse 1. And Yahuwah said unto Moshe, Hew thee two tables of stone like unto the first, and I will write upon these tablets, the words which were in the first tablet which thou breakest. Anybody notice the difference between what was going on in Exodus the 24th chapter verses 12 to 13 versus Exodus the 34th chapter verse 1?
Yahuwah wrote the first one. He wrote the first one himself.
Right. Very, very good observation. Give me more. There's something else here in verse 20, in Exodus the 24th chapter. Stone. That's what I'm looking at here. The tables of stone. So at the first account, we see now these tables of stones are representing, of course, it's a Hebrew idiom referring now to who said that? Somebody said something? Right, exactly. So at the first account now, we see now the groom, which is Yahushua HaMashiach, giving his heart to the bride. Because it made mention in 24 now is that the stones was already there, and Moses took the stones and went down to the nation of Yasharon. So what I'm trying to show here now is that the groom emptied himself to the bride first. And when Moshe came from off the mountain, what did he see? Right, he had returned back to water. And how long was he up there to the top of the mountain?
40 days.
40 days. So we see this this situation happening twice. We know that the 40 represents what? Atonement. Comes down to see the bride after 40 days, she's committing adultery already. She's not following Torah. In Exodus, the 34th chapter, it's saying the commandments is given now for Moses now to actually to hew out two stones himself. So now what happens now is that, listen, I did all I can for you. I gave you my heart at the beginning. Now, in order for you now to be in covenant relationship to me, with me, you're going to now have to give me your heart. Okay? So this is going to take a sacrifice here. Because we had even talked about this before with prayer. And we get into that a little bit later on how to pray. Because people pray, Father, do this for me, bless me with this, bless me with that, bless me with peace and serenity in my home, bless me to go back and forth to work. But they don't understand now is that there's something, every single time that you pray, there's something that you must do in return. Because if you're not doing that, you're looking at the Father as a genie where you just keep rubbing the lamp and you say, gimme, 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 and you're not doing anything in return. The Father's not hearing your prayers. Because prayers are also a sign or symbol of what? Mm-hmm. Worship. It's a form of worship. It's a sacrifice. It's a sacrifice. It's a pledge. So you can't be like, gimme, 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 gimme all the time. What is it that you want? Sometimes I say, ta-da, thank you. And go about your business. So again, we see now on the number 40 represents atonement. Moses goes up to the top of the mountain the second time. And according to the 360-day count, we had talked about that briefly a couple of months ago, and this is a prophetic calendar, a prophecy. We talked about a 364-day count, and we talked about a star count. We talked about a whole couple of different things. Watch how the math adds up with prophecy, 360. Moshe goes up to the top of the mountain in the month of Tishri. The month of Tishri is the sixth month. He comes down 40 days later, which now brings us to the seventh month. What day is it? In Hebrew months. Somebody said.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody will be here to say it.
Gregorian name?
You said September?
Yeah.
You said September. Absolutely right, it's September. September 1. Because it's coming down 40 days later. Mm-hmm. Remember now, the month of Tishrei, which is the sixth month, he's there for 40 days. If he's there for 40 days, we're at September, what day? You said it. You said the Day of Atonement? Exactly, it's the Day of Atonement. Because if there's 30 days in the sixth month, mm-hmm. and then you count 10 days in the seventh month, that gives you the 10th day, which is the Day of Atonement. Mm-hmm. So all this while Israel, okay, was away from Moshe, they're actually waiting for the verdict. Because what atonement does now, it lets you know whether or not the Father is going to accept your forgiveness, your prayers of forgiveness. And this is a national holiday. Well, all Israel gets together in one accord and we pledge forgiveness for one another. That's what we're about to move to now. All right? This is where you might step on some toes, but it has to be said. All right? That Day of Atonement is very, very important because you don't want to be caught on the wrong end of the stick. I guarantee you, and you all know this. The Day of Atonement is so important. Now let's do it this way. Let's go to the book of Vayikra, the 23rd chapter. There's some Murray, if you can read verses 27 to 32. We're about to close it up, but we're going to try to close it up, close it out with a bang here. Let's go 27 to 32.
Vayikra, Leviticus 23, starting at verse 27.
Please, please pay very, very close attention.
Also, on the 10th day of this seventh month, there shall be a Day of Atonement. It shall be an holy or Kodesh or set apart convocation unto you. And ye shall afflict your souls and offer an offering made by fire unto the sovereign Yahuwah. And ye shall do no work in that same day, for it is a Day of Atonement, to make an atonement for you before the sovereign your Elohim. For whatsoever soul it be that shall not be afflicted in that same day, he shall be cut off from amongst his people. And whatsoever soul it be that doeth any work in that same day, the same soul will I destroy from amongst his people. Ye shall do no manner of work. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations and all your dwellings. It shall be unto you a Shabbat of rest, and ye shall afflict your soul. In the ninth day of the month, at even, from even unto even, shall ye celebrate your Shabbat.
Hallelujah. We need to examine that word afflict. Now, on the Day of Atonement, what do? We abstain from intercourse and from our foods. What are some of your favorite foods that you like?
Lamb.
Sir. Right, nefesh. Yes, absolutely, and we're going to be able to dig into that right now. We're going to do that. So, I was trying to break it in,
but that was Leviticus. What was that?
That was, Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, verses 27 to 32. So we abstain now from intercourse, our favorite foods. Anything else? Because I like cheesy white pizza with vegan pizza. That's awesome. So I'm going to inflict my soul, and I'm not going to eat those things. And anything that I like to do, I'm not going to do. But I like to eat.
No water.
No water. Exactly right. So everybody is in agreement and everything like that. You know, I always have a trick. Bro. I always have a trick something, right? Everybody knows that. So this is my challenge to the whole congregation. There is nowhere in Scripture when it tells you that was a damn atonement that you're not supposed to eat.
Mm.
The Hebrew word for foot is if you can get Rabbi Hoof to read it. That word foot was mentioned three times in Leviticus 23rd chapter, verse 27, 32. Yes.
Okay. So is this kind of, is this going along with like in Isaiah
58?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To show you how the Ruach was working, that's the next scripture that we launched.
Yep.
We're not missing here, our kid.
Yep.
We got it covered.
Well, I mean, the point I'm trying to get at, Moray, is the fact that, you know, he's dealing with your pleasures. You understand what I'm saying? Things that, because when you said, honestly, I never read anywhere where it said you're not supposed to eat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can't eat your favorite ice cream.
I it's something that clicked to me about, you know, about if you, if you abstain from your pleasures or the things that you really need, that's the fact that I, you know, because you're really supposed to be doing it for those in the congregation or those that, I don't know, we're going to talk.
Listen, we're going to get to it.
We're going
to
dig it out.
We're going to do it. I got you. Yes.
I was saying that you go out and help other people. You go out and like help the homeless,
yes,
the hungry,
yeah,
things like that, or is that something that...
Yes, absolutely. There's more to it.
No, go ahead.
You're definitely correct.
You're right.
Now listen, I'm not saying or against you not eating. That's not what we're getting at here. What I'm saying is that when you look at the word afflict, which we're going to have Rabbi Luz to read now here, is going to give us a totally different definition to what we might be accustomed to. Okay, because a lot of times we do things just because everybody else is doing it. But again, take your time. Do your own personal research. You're going to never find that the word afflict means don't eat. You can't eat your favorite cheeseburger tonight. Okay, what do we have, Rabbi Luz?
It says a primitive root through the idea of looking down or browbeating to compress literally or figuratively, transitive or intransitive, and this is a base self, affliction, cancer, chastise self, deal hardly with, defile, exercise, mm-hmm, force, gentleness, humble.
That's the word I'm looking for right here. Let's get some of that. Mm. There's another Strong's number that should also be attached as like a 63.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah. It says humble. Because what I didn't do, again, the Strong's is good. The Strong's is good, but there are other books out there that give better definitions, like the Hebrew lexicons, and I like Jeff Bennett, okay, because he goes into each Hebrew character and he begins to look at the Hebrew from a picture graph perspective, which is the way that we're supposed to be doing. But get the other definition. We're going to speed it up here a little bit.
63 is properly to eye or generally to heed, pay attention by implication, to respond.
To respond. Hold on for a second. To respond. Uh-huh.
By extent, to begin to speak.
Uh-huh.
Specifically to sing, to shout, testify, announce.
To testify. To announce. Is there anything more to that?
It says give account.
To give account.
To give account.
Now, based upon the definitions that, that we have here, to humble, to respond, to testify, to announce, on the Day of Atonement, what was Israel doing? They were asking the Father for forgiveness in preparation for the Feast of Sukkot. Are we all on the same page?
Yes.
So again, the Day of Atonement, you ask for forgiveness from the Father in preparation for the Feast of Sukkot. If you don't ask for forgiveness, you can't participate in the Feast of Sukkot. Meaning, every single person in this congregation here, if you have all against any of your brothers and sisters, and you don't make an atonement with them in asking for their forgiveness, according to Scripture, you can't go to the Feast of Tabernacles. You can't go. This is what's happening. I believe is out of ignorance, and out of ignorance is not a bad thing, because a lot of things I just don't know. But what is brought to your attention is going to be up to the individual on how fast they respond. I'm telling the congregation this. Sister, she's going to bring up now the dates. Any brother or sister in this congregation here that has issues with another brother or sister, if you don't clear it up, according to Scripture, this is not the side of God. If you don't clear it up before Scripture, technically you're not supposed to be at the Feast of Sukkot. You're not supposed to be there. What I found very interesting also, too, now, is that Ackworth, that's where it was at, Ackworth, Georgia? Ackworth, excuse me. To even simplify it and make it easy, was everybody in here immersed? Okay, some of us wasn't immersed, all right? But again, listening is going to be key here, okay? To listen. Moray, Lamont Yahoo said, this is what an immersion is. Any gripes, any hatred, any big, whatever it is that's going on in your life that you might have with your brother or sister, you leave it here today in the water. This is what you do. We are not supposed to be hearing of problems and issues that brothers and sisters are having with other brothers and sisters. This is 2016. There are still issues that brothers and sisters are having with one another. And I'm not talking about necessarily anybody in this congregation. We're talking about, what is this? Check the main, it's 30. So this is what's happening. You have gone through 30 atonements and have not forgiven your brother and sister for something that happened in 1986, and you want to participate in the Feast of Sukkot?
Wow.
You're a liar. It's who you are and what you are, according to Scripture. Because what you're doing now is that you're trampling over the blood of Yahuwah, not understanding what the blood of Yahuwah is all about. Now again, is there anybody here that believes and sees, Moray, you first, okay? Am I twisting or making Scriptures out the way that I want it to be? You can't do that. Yeah, you're not supposed to. Nah. And once you are immersed, that problem or issue is not supposed to come up again. Because we went to the book of Hebrews, the 10th chapter, where it said now that every year these priests now would go through these rites and offer up blood, these lambs and these bulls now, which should have now brought you back into no more remembrance of sin. But once the Messiah has come, and he died for the nation of Yasharal, and once you get immersed and become a new person, how is it now that you still have the old leaven? How is that? It's not making sense. To show you how important this whole process is with vows and agreements and the festivals of Yahuwah, because because I talked about how the Moedim existed from the very beginning. After the blood of the Lamb is shed, the instructions in Leviticus, the 12th chapter, is this: that there should be no leaven found in you. No leaven. But still, during Pesach, there's no leaven. During the Feast of Atonement, there's no leaven. And still, people are attending Shavuot. You can't attend Shavuot if you have problems with your brothers. That's the reason why, Zakane, if you don't mind, what I did now, I said, listen, Zakane, if I had done anything wrong to you, you or your family, I say this time and time again, if I've done anything, I apologize to you. He said, Zakane, listen, you haven't been making apologies to me. I understand that there's no issues between you and I. The reason why I had to do that, because I understand how important this is. I can't be a hypocrite in this walk here. Watch this, okay. Let's go to the book of Yeshayahu, the 58th chapter. So we talked about the word Anan. Because again, I'm just trying to show everybody that you can't do what you want to do. The scriptures say that we're supposed to bear one another's burdens. How many times are you supposed to forgive your brothers? Yeah, but see, there's no forgiveness here. Where's the forgiveness? Let's start at verse 1, and we're not going to read the whole thing, about 3 or 4 verses, and then we'll shut it down. It's just want everybody to understand how important these feasts are, and that we are responsible. You can't attend. You can do it at church. It's cool. You can do it at church, but you can't do it in the body of the Messiah. It's just not there. Well, I feel, and I think, and whatever, you know what,
Well, you can't even do it at church because they don't follow the feast day. So
yes.
You can't even do that.
If you want to approach a person, but they're not available, and you know they have someone to come and be trying to fix the problem, and they're still not, you know, there, and you try after the Day of Atonement, you still go to the feast day. You try to reach out, but it gets off.
Right. You know, you brought up something very important. Once you have made the attempt, okay, to try to rectify the problem, and the person is non-responsive, you have done your part. You're clean. You're clear. There's something important that your Ab has said to me months ago. He said that whenever there's an issue, he don't want to do it over the phone. He don't want to do it through text. He said he wants to do it this way.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody know what this is right here? Pani, face to face.
Yep.
That's the way that it's done. Not through text. Hey, brother, listen, you know what? I wronged you, and I'm just texting. I apologize. Nah. That's not how that works.
Not at all.
The father told Miriam and Aharon, listen, there's protocol here. When I speak to Moshe, I speak to him face to face. Alright? That way I get a chance to see, That way I get a chance, I get a chance to see now facial expressions.
Mm.
That's also a form of communication.
Mm-hmm.
I know whether or not you're listening to me based upon your facial expression. I can know whether or not you're paying attention and listening to me by body posture. Of course, the answer. Okay, are you finished yet? Come on.
Right.
All right? That's the way our people are. So that's the reason why, again, I'm not making these things up. Pani, it's face to face. So at the day, right before the Day of Atonement, you're going to have to humble yourself. It has nothing to do with grandma's biscuits that you can't eat during the Day of Atonement. It has nothing to do with that. What you're going to do now is humble yourself and go and say, listen, Moray, I apologize. If I offended you in any way, and you just can't say, listen, you need to be exact too. Brother, listen, you did X, Y, and Z, and I'm asking for forgiveness based upon specifics. The way that they do in the Catholic Church, remember the Catholic Church, they go into a booth and they say, Father, I've sinned, and he said whatever it is, whatever like that, and you're asking the person for forgiveness. That's how you humble yourself and you become great. That's how you do it. Fulfillment of the law, bear one another's burdens, and when you bear one another's burdens, it says then you fulfill the law. Where is the forgiveness at? Technically, you're not supposed to get at the Feast of Sukkot if you're not asking for forgiveness for issues that might be going on in your personal life or family, whatever the case like that might be. You're not supposed to be at the Feast of Sukkot.
So, if a person had a problem with you, they need to approach you. Like, if you didn't know anything was going on, they need to approach you.
Every circumstance is different. If the person didn't know, but what I would do is make every attempt, okay, to make sure that my slate is clean. That's that's the whole thing. Because again, at the day of judgment, as Yahuwah is keeping the records, because in the book of Deuteronomy, now it tells us now is that all these things are kept as a record. And so what's going to happen now is that once you get to that certain point where judgment day is there, you're not going to be able to lean on what your imam has said or your Abba has said. You're going to stand alone, just like the scripture tells us in, I think it's the second Ezra, that this path of righteousness is built for only one person at a time. Two people can't walk together, meaning that you're going to all have to be held accountable for what you did. You can't say, well, the Sadabah said this and that and everything like that. What you got to make sure now is that you understand covenants, atonements, Torah, all these things you need to be able to understand, because each and every one of us is going to be held accountable. Yeah, exactly. That's what the virgin does. I mean, she keeps her garments white. You don't want to be like the other five virgins who didn't have any oil in their lamps at the time when the father called for the wedding. All right? Any more questions? Isaiah, the 58th chapter, because what I'm trying to do is bring up the difference between Anah and another word. Did Anah have a hay at the end? I believe it did. It does, okay. Hallelujah, it does. Now, again, this has nothing to do with your favorite foods. Okay, just talk about making sure that you make this atonement with one another so that you can be in right accord, because there's absolutely no way in the world that you can say that you love your boy, but hate your brother and sister that you see every single day. You will have issues with them. It just doesn't work.
Yeah, so with that feast, right, not to fix it, it's really not about a feast, right? Because like when you said, you know, we got to get this right so we can go into this feast.
Right. And that's another thing too. Now, it doesn't say feast. It's not feast. It's actually, it's ha. It's a festival. These are the festivals. These are festivals of Yahuwah, not the feast of Yahuwah. Not the feast.
Okay.
Yeah. So, because feast is associated with eating, like Thanksgiving is a Thanksgiving feast.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, exactly. There's no problem. That's the reason why, again, when we look at the scriptures, we have to make sure that we look at it from a Hebraic perspective. These are festivals, and these festivals bring us in close relationship or a closer relationship with the groom and the father, or the father and the groom, that particular one, the father and the groom.
Wow.
Not about eating. Nope. It's like young Ron is telling me. He said, "Brother, listen. You know what? Right before the Day of Atonement, what do a lot of our people do? And I'm guilty of the same way.
Yep.
The first thing that we're going to do prior to the Day of Atonement is go out to the buffet and just eat all we can eat, food coming out of my ears. You know, and then so that should be able to sustain us now, where we're not hungry. Okay, during the Day of Atonement, and as soon as the Day of Atonement is over, you go back to the Papa's buffet again, and you fill your bellies all up again, and now you're all constipated and all backed up. You know, yeah. So again, we just try to make sure that everything is done in proper order and being able to understand the importance of the scriptures. Isaiah 58, because I know we're getting real long-winded here. I am anyway. So we haven't heard the knock, and everybody now understands, and you can do your own personal research. A knock does not mean that you don't eat your favorite cheese pizza. Okay, that's it. It has nothing to do with food. Okay, gotcha. Oh, I thought you were going to read it.
Oh, I can read it, yeah.
Okay.
Isaiah 58, starting at 1.
Yes, please.
Cry aloud, spare not. Lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgression, and the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily, and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness. Mm. And forsook not the ordinance of their Elohim. Mm-hmm. They ask of me the ordinances of justice. They take delight in approaching to Elohim. Mm. Wherefore have we fasted, say they.
Okay, fasted. That word fasted there should be the Hebrew word soon. Is that what you have?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay.
Say they, and thou seest not. Wherefore have we afflicted our soul? And thou takest no knowledge. Behold, in the day of your fast, you find pleasure and exact all your labors.
So the day of your fast, I'm very meticulous when I read scripture. So your fast, the scripture even talks about, I hate your feast days.
Yep.
So there are people who say, listen, see, the Father hates the festivals. That's not what he says. It's that Yasharal had went about now to pervert, the festivals of Yahuwah. And they're not, and you can't call them the festivals of Yahuwah. Meaning this, and this whole thing was Ketubah. I'm trying to finish this up, okay? The word Ketubah, all right, Ketubah. Just because you write a piece of documentation and put the word Ketubah up there, it doesn't mean that it's a Ketubah. That's not what a ketubah means. Just because I put the word ketubah on it. If I wrote a ketubah and said, listen, you know what? I'm going to write a ketubah where every Tuesday I'm going to beat my wife at 12 o'clock. Is that a ketubah?
No.
Is this a ketubah where two homosexuals are going to come here and they're going to express their love for one another, put the word ketubah up there? Is that binding under Torah? Is that a ketubah?
No.
So a ketubah must follow the instructions of Torah.
Yes.
If it's not Torah based, it is not a ketubah. Let's not get it twisted. There's so much. Okay, we are. It's just that some things, it gets like, wow, really? Really, two women want to get married, okay, and you do the wedding vows, but they also do ketubahs. That is not binding. That person then comes to you, Rob Bubbles, okay, because you're now a chief officer. That means that you reside over certain things. So it gets to the point now where this person comes to you and you're reading over their wedding contract, you're like, well, first of all, now, this Mary wants to marry Jane, and you I need scripture and verse to prove to me in situations like that where I can beat my wife every Tuesday at 12 o'clock and say, well, she put a signature here. So I have a right to beat her every Tuesday at 12 o'clock. But I need chapter and verse to prove that. That's not Torah. But these are some of the things that's going on. You won't be surprised. There's a lot of craziness that's going on out here. Yes. See the whole end?
Yeah, I was going to ask that.
We understand that two should be in line with scriptures, with Torah.
Right.
But there are certain specific things that a man may say to a wife, or a woman may say to a man, particularly a man may say to a wife.
Right.
In order to protect herself, it should be written.
Right.
Or there might be something specific to a marital couple that should
The word betrothal, kiddushin. Before marriage takes place, everybody's supposed to go through what we call a betrothal period, where they get to know now want to know one another. And this now, this is your protection stage here. You're on the betrothal. You're supposed to ask questions, making sure that this is what you want to get involved with. Once you've moved from this stage, kiddushin now, you're now entering to the stage of marriage. Like I've said so many times before, unless something has changed, no woman should get involved with a man that's not following Torah. No man should get involved with a woman that's not following Torah and vice versa. This is what we're trying to get at here. Because the Torah protects everybody. That's what it does. It protects both parties. And this is the reason why I've always said that covenants can't be broken. You can actually add to covenants, where it was taught by some that you can't add to a covenant. But the covenant or the agreement that you're writing would have to support, the first agreement. Because we know now that there's an Adamic covenant, there's a Noah covenant, but they're all springboarding, to the bigger manifestation of what the whole thing is about. Because again, you just read Hebrews the 10th chapter, where these things were a shadow of good things to come, which was the Messiah. So everybody's protected, and at the end of the day, if Torah is the defining factor, it should not be an issue. Because again, how can I say this? When you buy a house, the real estate agent would advise you to get a lawyer. Because this protects you. Just because something is in writing doesn't make it lawful. You go to court all the time, and the judge will look at the contract. He said that you can't do that. You've rented this apartment out to these people, and you didn't go through the proper channels. You didn't go to court. You didn't give them a letter of eviction and all these other things. And you just went into the person's apartment, took their furniture, put a padlock on the door. You can't do that. So any damages that occurred to that person's property because you threw it out on the curb, that landlord is not responsible for that. So again, just because it is written, it does not make it a contract, according to the eyes of Torah. And I'm going to show that in just a minute. But just to speed things up, if there's anything else. No, let me finish this, and then I'll answer the question. But the word that I wanted to look at was the word sum. And that word means to fast, where you're now abstaining. Yes.
So, if you put something into the tutor or you make a verbal agreement, is that not a vow? And does a vow not matter?
Yes, it does. But what I'm saying now is that each situation is different. And I brought out some situations, and the situation that I brought out was, beating your wife and all this other stuff and everything like that. But now, if the vow is scripture, and I can show scripture making what I wrote, what's the word I'm looking for? Valuable or what I write or what the person writes, it has to fall in line with scripture. Exactly. But there. If I make a vow, is it a vow according to Torah? Meaning this. Another example. I make a vow to you, and I say, listen. You know what? We make a vow, and I say, when I'm coming to your house, listen. I'm gonna support bacon and some of this and stuff like whatever like that. And both you and I, we sign and we agree to it. Is it now? Can I validate or can I show it in scripture Maury, I think you have something to say.
Well, can,
yeah.
Can I?
Yeah.
Can I for a second? First off,
okay.
You would not be asking me. You would not commit the vow to cook pork bacon. That's not what we do.
Right.
But if you are engaging me in the betrothal process and you're saying things, making vows that seem pleasing to the ear.
Exactly.
Okay.
Right.
And you're saying this because there is something that you want. Are you saying that's not Torah, so therefore those vows do not have to be honored?
Yes, they do like this. In the betrothal part of the arrangement that the man is supposed to be making with the woman, there's supposed to be now, in Islam they call him an imam, here we call him a more, somebody that's residing over the union that you two are making. So every step of the way, he is supposed to act now as an overseer over this possible arrangement of a marriage. And so if anything comes up as he begins to make these vows, a more will say, listen, you know what? He can say this and he can do this, but this he can't do because I can't find that in scripture. So people can say things, but my question is, as we talked about before, if the Torah existed from the very beginning, and if we look at now Exodus the 20th chapter and Deuteronomy the 6th chapter, all throughout the scriptures, we already have a template that was already set on how a ketubah works. It was already set. What you and I need to do is to make sure that everything that I'm saying and promising you now falls in line with Torah. That's what we have to do. And this is new to all of us. I'm learning, you're learning, we're all learning. But what I'm trying to do now is tell everybody who's ever engaged in a betrothal, nobody's trying to get into your business, but there should be someone looking over the relationship to make sure that both parties are protected. Because I just can't say anything. Because I'm going to tell you what happens. Meishan had talked about this a couple weeks ago. It is not like the nature of the beast, but it's not the right thing to do. Man sees woman because man is a hunter and he pursues the woman. Man will say anything, okay, to get the goods. Mm-hmm. You, as the woman, need to do now is to make sure now is that these things don't happen. So you can't mistreat the daughters of Israel, as it tells us now in the book of Malachi, the second chapter, verses like 1 to 14, especially verse 14. What I'm trying to do is to make sure, and everybody that's here, we want to make sure that you are protected. Ask questions. It's too many times that the intimate part then comes, and then the woman or the man then say, well, listen, you know what? You didn't tell me this, you didn't tell me that. So you told me all these things just for us to be intimate, but we didn't go through the proper channels because a lot of things that you were saying, you know that you couldn't keep, you know that you couldn't do, and furthermore, it's not even Torah. It's not Torah. And it ended. Yeah, you lied. You lied. Yeah, simple as that, yeah. Yeah, kafah, you lied.
It doesn't matter if you lie or not. If a man or a woman makes a vow, they're supposed to hold to, period. Whether you lied or not. And it could be to your own hurt that you made that vow.
You're right. See what's going on. When he started this lesson on today, there was something very important y'all should have got. We have the best example of a relationship between Shia Yahusha and Abiyur. Absolute, total obedience to the head, the strength, and the authority of the house. Now what happens is, I don't care what the Shia did, I want y'all to listen to me good. You cannot usurp authority over the man. I don't care what, in a relationship, ketubah or not, when Mashiach established something with Adam and Kawa, Adam and Eve, When did he tell that woman?
Should you rule over your wife?
Well, what's that again?
Rule over your wife.
Rule over your wife. That's nothing negative. That's nothing bad. I'm going to tell you what happens with relationships. A lot of times, we want vows and stuff. Let me tell you, if we're following the Torah, absolute obedience to the Torah, you're protected anyway. No matter, you don't need, I don't have to put this in and say, I won't do this, I won't do that. Because what you're trying to do is, you're trying to institute or place something within agreement that's going to cause you to be out of order. Now you start a part of you place yourself over the man because you stipulate something that ties his hands. Not about what Torah said. Now you afraid of something. This is why Shaul said, crucify our flesh what? Daily. If flesh beginning to work down. Do y'all hear me? Flesh is beginning to work. You have a fear of something. So now what I'm going to do, I'm going to institute something. I asked to put something. Y'all remember what I said to some of y'all about 2 weeks ago? I said, when it comes to America at Sinai, what happened at that mountain? Who did all the talking? The only thing that Esau said was, we will do, or I do. She agreed to his terms. Since when we got all of this stuff, now we finna throw something in. This is finna get you in trouble. This is finna get you, first of all, you're out of line, out of place. Now, this is what happened. Any Torah about a man, he's going to love you, he's going to protect you, he's going to provide for you. Now, all this other stuff that we're trying to worry about, this is flesh. This is flesh, and this is why we can't do the will of the Father. Because our flesh is alive. You just see Mashiach say anything. He was in total obedience to who? The Father. Guess what we have to be total obedience to? The Father. The Father put that husband at the head in the house for a reason. You cannot ask for put some here, do this, that, and the other to restrict or usurp authority over that man because you don't want to look at it as that, but that's what it is. When he should be in the position and he's ruling and leading the guy, now all of a sudden he's walking on eggshell, he can't do this because your flesh is alive.
Then that man should keep his mouth closed because there's times when I'm dealing with women, like you said, men promise things. And based on the promise in the betrothal period, she says, okay, I'm going to now go with you. And then he flips it and says, I never told you that. I have, Lamont and Yahoo and I had a conversation on YouTube. If a man promises a woman in the betrothal stage that he's not going to do X, Y, and Z so that he can pursue her and she can come with him, can she ask that be put in their ketubah? He said, yes, it can. And the reason why it can is so that it is put in writing what he said to her verbally. Nobody twists or tries to assert authority over a man. But if a man talks too much, sometimes those vows bind him and you cannot release from those vows. He should not talk.
Okay, is the vow, what do you say, is it in Torah?
It doesn't matter.
Uh-oh. Wait.
This is what we're getting
at. This is why he should not talk. Sometimes men make vows and women make vows against Torah. And then the person says, oh, okay then. Well, are you sure you're going to do that? Oh yeah, I'm going to do that. And then they turn around and want to change things.
That's all what that is. I mean, it was a lie, it was a game. So what I found interesting now was that whether it's in Torah or not, he's still obligated to doing what he's saying. So the man made a vow to a woman, and it is not scriptural, he must still keep it. I just need a scripture and an address, and that's all I need. I need a scripture for that.
Why can't he even do that in the world? Why can't he? Part of the contract is against the laws of
it, it has to fall within side of the rules and regulations of even America.
So what if a man says, this is who I'm talking about. like I said, the basis of Torah is ketubah, fine. But there's individual couples that outside, that it might work for you guys, but it's not going to work for us. So now we need to discuss those things. Where are we going to live? How many children do we expect? What's the remedy if there is no children? What is the remedy of that? Those are discussions that also need to be had and written down. Now you say, well, that's not Torah.
But according to who that is, we discussed written down.
This is the problems that couples have get in trouble with. So now when we don't have, now when certain things are not done, what is the remedy to it? It needs to be discussed and it needs to be written down.
Well, the only thing that needs to be discussed is what that man wants. Let me give you a proper example. When Yahshua was being led and guided by their groom or their husband, y'all remember when they were in the wilderness? How were they led? By what? Cloud by day and what by night? Pillar by fire by night. What was Yahshua doing while her groom was sitting still? She was sitting up behind that, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
What did she do when her groom, her head moved?
She moved.
And when he stopped, what did she do?
She stopped.
She sat up behind that. Absolute obedience to the each, the head. See, now, when this grows out, I'm trying to show up to bring y'all back to the flesh. The only reason we're talking about, if that man ain't talking about you, you ain't talking about you. If he ain't talking about what happened in this situation, you ain't talking about it. It just is what it is. See, that's why I'll be prepared to be seen for the rest of my life. Because, oh, you have to line up with kids. It's just, that's how it is. That's just how it is.
If he's not talking about children, she shouldn't be talking about children?
If he's not, she shouldn't be.
Really?
Wow.
Really?
Right.
She should be asking him, if you don't want children, then I should move forward.
Right.
So if he's not talking about children and she wants children, that's going to cause a problem in itself.
But hold on. But see, you just said. Think about this, what she just said. If he's not talking about children, but she's talking about it, a ketubah is about what he wants. You agree to the terms of his contract. Y'all should all agree to the terms of what Yahuwah wanted. Yahusha on it. This is what I'm trying to show y'all.
And my question was based on him saying, or he came across that if a man lies, that's okay with him. My point is, we're all trying to follow Torah. Why are we lying in the beginning to persuade people to do certain things?
Right, but these are things that's happening. And this is what I'm trying to express, that there should be no lying. There's not supposed to be any lying. Everybody's supposed to be upfront with everybody. So there's no problems.
Yes.
Right, so that was it. But watch this now, is that a question came up.
Right.
What is the remedy was the question. If there's a situation that's going on, like I said so many hours ago, the remedy did the remedy change? Isn't the remedy still the Torah?
Yep.
Yes.
The remedy is still the Torah. It's still the Torah. I mean, there's no other way around it. I'm trying to, you know what? I have had councils where both men and women have lied. Every single body lied. Okay? And what's happening now is that we're trying now to make sure that we understand exactly what it is that we are responsible for during the betrothal. We do ask, listen, you know what? What is it that, I do want to know about your feelings. I do, because there's even the teachings that, you know what, we don't care about women's feelings. Mm-hmm. So when it comes down to the betrothal part of this marriage, we're getting to know one another. What is it that you like? What is it that you don't like? Blah, 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 and everything like that. So at the end of the duration of the betrothal, we now say, listen, you know what? Do you want to marry? And the person either has a power to say yes or no. You are not bound to say yes. You're not. I don't want anybody to think. Did anybody here, throughout the conversation that I had today, I said I was talking about polygyny?
No.
No. Taking more than two. Yehovah bears me witness. That's not what the class was about. Did Mormon call you and ask you about the Day of Atonement? That's what I was going to be talking about for the most part today?
Yes.
That's what I did. That's what I did. And trying to line up how we need to ask for forgiveness amongst one another so that we can be prepared for the Feast of Tabernacles. That's all I said. And trying to explain the importance now of making sure that we understand that Yahweh sent his son, Yahusha, a Mashiach, to be that covenant, that brit. He made an atonement for the nation of Yasharol, and being that he lowered himself, okay, to be in subjection to the Father, we should also now be willing to lower ourselves down, asking for forgiveness to one another. That's what the class is about. That's it. When our emotions start to overcome Torah, it's going to cloud the vision. I have all these witnesses here. It's not about polygyny. Can somebody please go to the book of Romans, the 12th chapter, verses 1 to 2?
Romans 12?
Romans, the 12th chapter, verses 1 to 2.
Romans 12. I beseech you, therefore, brethren.
I beseech you, therefore, brethren.
By the mercy of Yahuwah.
The word mercy is the word that Rav Aluf used about 3 weeks ago, and a Hebrew idiom for mercies is what? Redemption. Salvation. So read it again.
I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy or redemption of Yahuwah, that you present your body a living sacrifice.
A what?
A living sacrifice.
Go ahead.
Set apart, acceptable unto Yahuwah, which is your reasonable service.
Which is your reasonable service. So that means now that in order to be in covenant relationship with the Father, it is your reasonable responsibility now to also be a living sacrifice for the Father. In return, for he died for you. I'm still not able to understand where a body has thou prepared me from the beginning. I love you so much. If you can understand that, I love you so much. This is what the Father is saying. I love you so much. I already know that your vision is going to get cloudy. I already know that. But I love you so much. I'm going to send my son to die for you, to bring you back in covenant relationship with me, because I hate divorce. I love you. I love you. There's no greater love that a man can have than to give his life for his brothers. What am I saying wrong? But nobody wants to be that sacrifice, that zavak, to love one another, to bear one another's burdens. Is anything that I'm saying that's not scriptural? Okay, 2 Samuel. The 3rd chapter. Second Samuel, the 3rd chapter. Start at the 1st verse and read down to 13 and I'm done. If anybody have any questions, please address those questions. And I'm going to show beyond a shadow of a doubt, and I'm up to the challenge for anybody, any single body, okay, proving any scripture that I brought out today was wrong. I'm teaching sisters to do their investigations. I'm teaching men to do their investigations so that the covenant between the two works. It has to work. But if Torah is not the foundational basis of your relationship, it's going to fail. I will tell you straight off the bat, if I'm not following Torah, don't trust me, because I'm going to stab you in your back, all right, if I'm not following Torah. What keeps the blood or the relationship between you and I is that you can honestly, you would have to say, listen, you know what? Kasanaba is not going to take my wife. Kasanaba is going to be straight up with his wife. He's going to be loving and kind to all of the brothers because I know that he's going to follow Torah. That's why I love him, because he follows Torah. That's the only reason why. Not because the son of God can build a house. Because when I look at the scriptures, that's not a qualification to prove that I love Torah. Now, I'm not saying that, you know, you should learn how to live in a house. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm just trying to say that when we look at the scriptures now, what are the credentials that a person needs now in order to be in covenant relationship with the Father? 2 Samuel, the third chapter, verse 1 to 12.
Now, there was long war between the house of Shaul and the house of David.
I think that might be, let's try 1 Samuel. Let's just get it right quick. 1 Samuel, make sure that I got this correct. The man wasn't able to handled the business because of his personal feelings that was going on at this particular time, listen, no problem. All right, daddy's home. You don't want daddy to come home and handle the situation. I guarantee you, none of us want that. As we used to say back in North, and I'm sure we said it down here too, you don't want that. You never want the father to step in and handle the situation. Read on.
For I have told him that I will judge his house forever.
I'm going to judge his house forever. Go ahead.
For the iniquity which he knoweth.
For the iniquity that he knoweth. You as the man of that house, and you know that there's iniquity or some misunderstanding in that house, and you don't correct it, the father said, I got you. Huh? You don't want the father to step in, I guarantee you, because the first time we saw that happen, it happened in the Garden of Eden. Okay? And when Adam didn't handle his responsibilities, guess what? Listen, both of you get your crap and get the heck up out of here. We're not having this here. Because in my father's house, we are all in one accord. Read on, watch what's about to happen. Because Eli knew that there was a problem. Read on.
Because the sons made themselves vow, and he restrained them not.
Whoa! So he knew that his children was out of order, and he didn't restrain them. Read on.
And therefore I have sworn unto the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall be purged with sacrifice nor offering forever.
Will not be purged, right?
Shall not be purged.
Okay.
With sacrifice nor offering forever. And Samuel lay until the morning and opened the doors of the house of the sovereign. And Samuel feared to show Eli the vision. Then Eli called Samuel and said, Samuel, my son. And he answered, here am I. And he said, what is the thing that the sovereign has said unto thee? I pray thee, hide it not from me. Yahuwah do so to thee, and more also, if thou hide anything from me of all the things that he said unto thee. And Samuel told him every whit, and hid nothing from him. And he said, it is the sovereign. Let him do what seemeth him good. And Samuel ruled, and the sovereign was with him, and he did let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan even to Beersheba knew that Samuel was established to be a prophet of the sovereign.
What verse you in now?
I'm at the last one, I'm 21 now.
You got 3 and 21?
Uh-huh.
Oh, my fault, like you wanted to stop at
15.
At 13. Yeah, my fault. What I wanted to show here, unless somebody is saying something totally different. We have talked about this for months. That the head of the house is actually the strength, the strong leader. He controls and watches over the house. Right? Now, hypothetically, if there was something going on in my house, and I knew that something was wrong, and I swept it underneath the rug. I know there's a problem. And I swept it underneath the rug as if it's not there. So every single day I'm getting up and I'm walking over this big lump that's in my carpet, and I know that there's an issue. Being that Eli, you know that there's an issue in your house, and you being the head or the olive of your house, and you didn't correct your problem, I'm going to judge you. You and your sons. All that I'm saying is make sure that you take care of your responsibilities. All right, don't play games with the father, because you don't want to fall into the father's hands, where now he's going to say, listen, you know what, you can't handle it, I'll handle it. And the father is like a horticulturist, and this is a person that deals with plants, and we know that they're kind of rough. The father moves real rough. You ever seen a person that deals with plants, you know, they're not all tender, they're taking a plant out of the cup, and I'm careful, it's a rough move. And being that, you know, we are rough people, you have to deal with rough people rough ways. You do. I mean, we're all stubborn people. It tells you that in the book of Ezekiel, I think like the 4th chapter.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? You know, their heads are hard as flint.
Yes.
All right? So I just wanted to end the class here Just talking about, again, the topic, oh, so there's the problem. There's no polygyny here. It's not here. I'm talking about making sure that everybody is prepared for a very important festival that's coming up. First, there is Yom Teruah. Yom Teruah is what? The announcement of the coming of the king. When you make the announcement of the coming of the king, you're supposed to not be preparing to meet the king. Because remember the parable about the brides. Only five were ready. What I'm trying to do, Maury's trying to do, and all of us are trying to do, is make sure that the bride is ready. This is what this class was about. We have Yom Teruah coming up, and then after Yom Teruah, now we have the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement now is that, listen, you want to have to make sure if there's any issues with anybody, you have to make this pani-pani, face-to-face discussion on how I wronged you, get over it, and move on. That's how it works. You cannot get immersed, because I made a vow to unto Yahuwah. Whatever happened wrong with in my personal relationship or with anybody, I'm not bringing it up no more. It's done. It's a wrap. I made a vow in front of everybody here. It is done. I'm not bringing it up no more because I believe through the blood of Yahushua HaMashiach that that person's sins were redeemed. I was redeemed. Let's move on because we get nowhere if you keep rehashing, bringing up the same thing over and over and over again. You now make the Torah a lie. And we can't have that. You have the Day of Atonement. Then after the Day of Atonement, you have the Feast of Sukkot. The Feast of Sukkot is when the groom and the bride are supposed to tabernacle together. That's the end gathering. And then after that, you have Shemini Atzeret. Okay, that was the great day. This is now where now everything is done. We're finished. It's a wrap. And one more thing. What's so important about the seventh month, the tenth day, we're talking about a little bit, the seventh month, tenth day, is that the shofar is blown. The shofar is blown in the seventh month, the tenth day, making the announcement that the next year is the Jubilee year when your redemption takes place. That's what the whole thing means. Mr. Picard, I pray that we were able to get some understanding out of today's lesson. It was not about religion, please. It was about preparing for the Day of Atonement. I have it written here. It's in writing. So let's now work on more greater things. If there's any brother or sister in this congregation, if you want to be part of Sukkot, according to Scripture, it had to make amends with your brothers and sisters. Stand up. If there's any questions, we can stand up and pray.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Okay, so we're going to face the east. We're going to do the same thing. We're going to have Moshe to pray. Maybe if we get another brother to pray at the end, right?
I'm not ready yet.
You're not ready?
just
listen,
said.
Listen, let your rock move you, okay? Do the prayer, I can. You got it, all right? Don't even worry about it. You got it.
Yeah. All right. Father Almighty, thank you so much for bringing us together, helping us get on one accord so that we may move in unison. I pray that you continue to grow and establish us in peace, love, and your son's name, we pray. Bless you.
If you can bring those things to everybody's attention so that everybody can be on one accord and knowing exactly what it is that needs to be done. So we have Sister Shoshana to come up. I believe Maisha, she has some information to bring out. Jacqueline has some information to bring out. Do you have any information to bring out? Okay. And we'll take it from there, all right? You're on, my sister.
Try to keep things simple.
also decided what I wanted me to bring up to the congregation. And I'm going to put it in an email for Rod to send it out to people who are not here, that during this set apart convocation, during this set apart convocation, the 7 days, there's no sexual intercourse. And on the campsite, there's no sexual intercourse.
Again, it's a holy convocation for 7 days, all right? We're going to respect everyone. We're going to have tents, all right? And we just ask everybody to be mature about the whole thing. And that's not all right? I'm not just saying these things just for the fun. And that's how.
Also wanted to let everyone know that we are not, we're not accepting anyone else for support. We're at our capacity. We couldn't possibly put any other families on the campsite. Remember that by next week, September the 17th, your monies are due for the campsite. No later than September the 17th.
There were some sisters that were asking me about, they know that the campsite is full. Is there another campsite that they can fellowship with us, or can they drop out and fellowship for that day and drop back? They want to know if that was an option as well.
Yeah. If they wanted to do a campsite on their own, I'm not organizing that. They can. They can call Stone Mountain and set up their own reservations, but I'm not setting that up.
No, they're going to set up themselves. They want to know if there was no campsite, they can't get a campsite. Can they come out, fellowship, like we get the agenda together and say it starts at 9 o'clock?
No.
Come out at 9.
No.
Can I add that the way I was told by Stone Mountain was that they would do random head checks and just tell them what time that's going to be. So if there's more there at our campsite, sign up for it. They would make the adjustments in our bill. So those people. Need to rent their own site. That way, if they come, we can say, okay, these people are in campsite I,
right,
or M, or whatever. So, the answer to that question is no.
They can't come in and fellowship.
Yeah, because what's happening is that the way that things were running, like the last 2 days, like Aisha and I, we were getting phone calls, really like crazy. They don't know if you want to down on the tent. And they said, well, can we just attend and grab something to eat? But the numbers were starting to get astronomical almost. Where now it's going to get to the point now with the monies that Maury Eliyahu have put together, because we're coming out of our own pockets with this. We're not asking the congregation for any of this. The personal money that's coming out of my pocket and Lamont, we're taking care of everybody's food. So that means now is that if 40 extra people come, they're going to want food to eat, but that's taken away from you. I would love to. This is our first time doing Sukkot, so we're asking everybody if you could just please be patient and work with us. Next year, we could probably do better, but we're not going to be able to feed every single body that's coming through because the numbers started to get crazy. I got a phone call this morning, it was 9:42 this morning, and there's a couple that wants to come down. People are emailing us pictures of their checks. Please put us in. Please put us in. I mean, so it's getting, we just can't do it. And one more quick thing. If you saw the campsite, the reason why we have a cap on it, now you can get 60, maybe 70 people on the campsite. You can do that. But you can't set up 70 tents because tents take up room. We have no more room. Yes.
What were we supposed to tell you if you were interested in going? You were supposed to have already told you that?
Tell you what?
Tell you, like, to when you wanted, if you're interested in staying on the site, were we already supposed to have told you that? Or got you the money? You said get the money next week, but
right.
We should have already told you.
Yeah, I already have you on the list.
First, he knows, right?
Oh, I just want to know, that can't pass out everybody. I hope everybody got one. Just got a quick announcement to make, to try to bring us up to speed on what we're doing as a family, not as an individual. This is a family thing. What we've been working on is trying to get on the TV show. We're there. But the problem is we're going to need everybody's participation. This is just not an individual thing. We were shooting for tomorrow. That's not going to happen. But we got next week to shoot on. We're going to be coming on at 8 o'clock, Channel 25. But this is just the plug-in where we're just going to be doing tapes. But we're going to do a live show. We've got to get with the guy at the end of this month. That's where we're going to need participation of everybody. Everybody needs to learn how to do this. Because if I can't be here, you can be there. I'm going to start off. This is my first time doing it. We got Brother Aaron, who went through all this. He knows how to do it. But he's working with us out of Florida, which is still good. Because all he can do is upload into the production area, and then you can bring them up. But the live class, we're going to need everybody's participation. Because we've got brothers now already signed up. I'm going to be a producer, but guess what? You need to learn how to be a producer as well. Everybody's going to know everybody's position. This is how this thing can work. Because what they have is something good. We need to put it out there. We need to let people know that we are here preaching this book. And it's going to take everybody. And it's not our job, it's the Father's work we're doing, not our work. But thank you to all the brothers that's already signed up, that's willing to work with us. We've got a squad so far first. It's going to take, I think, 3 or 4 people to do it. We're going to need a reel. Now, can sisters read you?
Yes.
I'm saying, you sisters can.
Yes.
But
you said Channel 25,
is that Comcast? It's Comcast. This is Comcast, yes. Now, of course, the. How far it's going to reach out? I think it reaches out to Atlanta, Conyers, and part of Lake County. But what we're doing, we're going to establish one in Atlanta as well. It's called People's TV. That's going to be the live show. So we got to, if you're part of the live show, you got to show up an hour early to get everything going. If we don't show up, the show does not go on. And we've got a season. I think the season consists of 12 months. So we want to be able to show what we have to the world, to our community.
Now, when you say, what do you want people to, I mean, you need like a teleprompter, somebody
teleprompter,
to type in the scriptures?
People to run this camera, readers, this different position. I will get back with you and let you know what we need. So.
Okay, you know, I've been bugging about the flyer. Lately, I keep my hand on the flyer.
Because
that's a big part of, you know, putting stuff out here so people would know about it. Waiting on the flyer.
Salvi's putting that together. We will have the time of the show, the location. We will have emails, their emails, and we'll have a phone, live phone. We'll be able to answer the phone. We have direct message to Kasalaba Eliyahu. Kasalaba is putting flyers together.
This is the live show?
The live show will be September. We got to find out the time slot. The time slot we have now is 8 o'clock, which is good. Football game be over with. So, brothers, you ain't got to worry about that. The live show we're working on, we're trying to get Tuesday, right, where it works with Kasalaba time being off. We're shooting for like an 8 o'clock class as well.
So the recorded show is going to be on Sunday?
The recorded show is going to be on Tuesday, because that's when it's out of our house. We're shooting for that time.
Okay.
The show that's being taped will be on Sunday.
That's right.
Right. But the thing about this Sunday show is that they don't have a building right now. That's why I say we need everybody's participation. When they get a building, guess what? We're live too on Sunday. But what we can do is that we may rotate live 1 week, tape the next week. Because we don't want to wear everybody out with 2 shows going on. But this is what we're doing. So, like I said, we want everybody to participate. We can find a job for everybody. Don't say, I can't. Yes, you can. This is new with me. I don't know how to do it. Guess what? The Father's going to show me. Because this is his will is being done,
right,
not mine. So I just want to keep you guys updated. What's going on? We was planning on having a show tomorrow, but technical difficulty, we're not going to have a show tomorrow. will be this week.
Hallelujah.
That's all for now. We'll keep you posted, though. Any other questions?
Because everybody knows that we have Lore Eliyahu. He's also ministering every
Friday night.
Yes, so he's been doing that. And yeah. And him and I have, and with Rob, we've been alternating. So we're going to have to keep in contact because we might need some assistance. But we're not might, we are going to need some assistance with the live show where we're going to need you to actually to be live.
Things hinder and cut up to keep the favor of the Most High from flowing in your life. But he's not going to operate in confusion. That's just not going to be there. Because if there's confusion, there's no accord. And so let's keep these things in mind. And first of all, while we're talking about offending, let me get it so y'all can see me.
I said,
first of all, yeah, you're right, because I'm finna apologize because my actions last week were not appropriate. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, you're okay.
And I owe this entire congregation an apology, and I want y'all to, I'm sorry for my actions and the way I handled my anger and things. Because we have to make things right. Because one thing I always want to keep in mind, y'all don't belong to me, y'all don't belong to Messiah. Y'all belong to Yahuwah. You're his people.
That's right.
And so I have to be careful how I handle you because you don't, you're not mine, you're his. And so I just want to ask y'all, let every last one of y'all know, I'm sorry, I was wrong, and I ask for your forgiveness. Ain't no ands and buts about it. I was wrong.
Goodness.
We love you, man.
Yes.
We love you,
Mom. Okay. Hey, I love you like a piece of cake.
Yeah.
When Mashiach established something with Adam and Kawa, Adam and Eve, what did he tell that woman?
Should you rule over your wife?
Well, what's that again?
Rule over your wife.
Rule over your wife. That's nothing negative. That's nothing bad. I'm going to tell you what happens with relationships. A lot of times, we want vows and stuff. Let me tell you, if we're following the Torah, absolute obedience to the Torah, you're protected anyway, no matter, you don't need, I don't have to put this in and say, I won't do this, I won't do that. Because what you're trying to do is, you're trying to institute or place something within an agreement that's going to cause you to be out of order. Now you start a part of, you place yourself over the man because you stipulate something that ties his hands. Not about what Torah said, now you're afraid of something. This is why Shaul said, crucify our flesh what?
Daily. Yeah.
If flesh beginning to work down, do y'all hear me? Flesh is beginning to work. You have a fear of something. So now what I'm going to do, I'm going to institute something, ask to put something. Cause y'all remember what I said to some of y'all about 2 weeks ago? I said, when it comes to America at Sinai, what happened at that mountain? Who did all the talking? The only thing that Esau said was, we will do, or I do. She agreed to his terms. Since when we got all of this stuff, now we finna throw something in. This is finna get you in trouble. This is finna get you, first of all, you're out of line, out of place. Now, this is what happened. Any Torah about a man, he's gonna love you, he's gonna protect you, he's gonna provide for you. Now, all this other stuff that we're trying to worry about, this is flesh. This is flesh, and this is why we can't do the will of the Father. Because our flesh is alive. You just see Mashiach say anything. He was in total obedience to who? The Father. Guess what we have to be total obedience to? The Father. The Father put that husband at the head in the house for a reason. You cannot ask for put some here, do this, that, and the other to restrict or usurp authority over that man because you don't want to look at it as that, but that's what it is. When he should be in the position and he's ruling and leading the guy, now all of a sudden he's walking on eggshell, he can't do this because your flesh is alive.
Then that man should keep his mouth closed because there's times when I'm dealing with women, like you said, men promise things. And based on the promise in the betrothal period, she says, okay, I'm going to now go with you. And then he flips it and says, I never told you that. I have, Lamont and Yahoo and I had a conversation on YouTube. If a man promises a woman in the betrothal stage that he's not going to do X, Y, and Z so that he can pursue her and she can come with him, can she ask that be put in their ketubah?
He said, yes, it can. And the reason why it can is so that it is put in writing what he said to her verbally. Nobody twists or tries to assert authority over a man. But if a man talks too much, sometimes those vows bind him, and you cannot release from those vows. He should not talk.
Okay, is the vow, what do you say, is it endured?
It doesn't matter. This is why he should not talk. Sometimes men make vows and women make vows against Torah, and then the person says, oh, okay then. Well, are you sure you're going to do that? Oh, yeah, I'm going to do that. And then they turn around and want to change things.
That's all what that is. I mean, it was a lie. It was a game. So what I found interesting now was that whether it's in Torah or not, he's still obligated to doing what he's saying. So the man made a vow to a woman, and it is not scriptural. He must still keep it. I just need a scripture and an address, and that's all I need. I need a scripture for that.
Why can't he even do that in the world? Why can't he? Part of contract is against the laws of
it, it has to fall within side of the rules and regulations of even America.
What if a man, now a man says, this is what I'm talking about. Like I said, the basis of Torah is ketubah. Fine. But there's individual couples that outside, that it might work for you guys, but it's not going to work for us. So now we need to discuss those things. Where are we going to live? How many children do we expect? What's the remedy if there is no children? What is the remedy of that? Those are discussions that also need to be had and written down. Now you say, well, that's not Torah.
But according to who that is, we discussed written down.
This is the problems that couples have get in trouble with. So now when we don't have, now when certain things are not done, what is the remedy to it? It needs to be discussed and it needs to be written down.
Well, the only thing that needs to be discussed is what that man wants. Let me be a proper example. When Yahshua was being led and guided by their groom or their husband, y'all remember when they were in the wilderness? How were they led? By what? Cloud by day and what by night? Pillar by fire by night. What was Yahshua doing while her groom was sitting still? She was sitting up behind that, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
What did she do when her groom, her head moved?
She moved.
And when he stopped, what did she do?
She stopped.
She sat up behind that. Absolute obedience to the each, the head. See, now, when this grows out, I'm trying to show up to bring y'all back to the flesh. The only reason why, if that man ain't talking about children, you ain't talking about children. If he ain't talking about what happened in this situation, you ain't talking about it. It just is what it is. See, that's why I'll be prepared to be seen for the rest of my life. You have to line up with kids. That's how it is. That's just how it is.
If he's not talking about children, she shouldn't be talking about children?
If he's not, she shouldn't be.
Really?
Right.
She should be asking him, if you don't want children, then I should move forward.
Right,
so if he's not talking about children and she wants children, that's going to cause a problem in itself.
Now hold on, but see, you just said, think about this, what she just said. If he's not talking about children, but she's talking about, a ketubah is about what he wants. You agree to the terms of his contract. Y'all should all agree to the terms of what Yahuwah wanted, or Yahusha wanted. This is what I'm trying to show y'all.
Everybody's supposed to be up front with everybody. So there's no problems.
Yes.
Right, so that was it. But watch this now, is that a question came up.
Right.
What is the remedy was the question. If there's a situation that's going on, like I said so many hours ago, the remedy, did the remedy change? Isn't the remedy still the Torah?
Yep.
Yes.
It's still the Torah. I mean, there's no other way around it. I'm trying to, you know what? I have had councils where both men and women have lied. Every single body lied. Okay? And what's happening now is that we're trying now to make sure that we understand exactly what it is that we are responsible for during the betrothal. We do ask, listen, you know what? What is it that I do want to know about your feelings. I do, because there's even the teachings that, you know what, we don't care about women's feelings. Mm-hmm. So when it comes down to the betrothal part of this marriage, we're getting to know one another. What is it that you like? What is it that you don't like? Blah, 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 and everything like that. So at the end of the duration of the betrothal, we now say, listen, you know what, do you want to marry? And the person either has a power to say yes or no. You are not bound to say yes. You're not. I was only, I don't want anybody to think, did anybody here throughout the conversation that I had today, I said, I was talking about polygyny?
No.
No. Taking more than two, Yahuwah beareth me witness, that's not what the class was about. Did Mormon call you and ask you about the Day of Atonement? That's what I was going to be talking about for the most part today?
Yes.
That's what I did. That's what I did. And trying to line up how we need to ask for forgiveness amongst one another so that we can be prepared for the Feast of Tabernacles. Right. That's all I said. That's it. And trying to explain the importance now of making sure that we understand that Yahuwah sent his son, Yahusha, a Mashiach, to be that covenant, that brit. He made an atonement for the nation of Yasharol, and being that he lowered himself, okay, to be in subjection to the Father, we should also now be willing to lower ourselves now, asking for forgiveness to one another. That's what the class is about. That's it. When our emotions start to overcome Torah, it's going to cloud the vision. I have all these witnesses here. It's not about polygyny. Can somebody please go to the book of Romans, the 12th chapter, verses 1 to 2?
Romans 12?
Romans, the 12th chapter, verses 1 to 2.
Romans 12. I beseech you, therefore, brethren.
I beseech you, therefore, brethren.
By the mercy of Yahuwah.
The word mercy is the word that Rav Aluf used about 3 weeks ago, and a Hebrew idiom for mercies is what? Redemption. Salvation. So read it again.
I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy or redemption of Yahuwah, that you present your body a living sacrifice.
A what?
A living sacrifice.
Go ahead.
Set apart, acceptable unto Yahuwah, which is your reasonable service.
Which is your reasonable service. So that means now that in order to be in covenant relationship with the Father, it is your reasonable responsibility now to also be a living sacrifice for the Father. In return, for he died for you. I'm still not able to understand where a body has thou prepared me from the beginning. I love you so much. If you can understand that, I love you so much. This is what the Father is saying. I love you so much. I already know that your vision is going to get cloudy. I already know that. But I love you so much. I'm going to send my son to die for you, to bring you back in covenant relationship with me, because I hate divorce. I love you. But nobody wants to be that sacrifice, that zavak, to love one another, to bear one another's burdens. Is anything that I'm saying that's not scriptural? Okay, 2 Samuel, the 3rd chapter. Start at the first verse and read down to 13, then I'm done. If anybody has any questions, please address those questions. And I'm going to show, beyond a shadow of a doubt, and I'm up to the challenge for anybody, any single body, okay, proving any scripture that I brought out today was wrong. I'm teaching sisters to do their investigations. I'm teaching men to do their investigation so that the covenant between the two works. It has to work. But if Torah is not the foundational basis of your relationship, it's going to fail. I will tell you straight off the bat, if I'm not following Torah, don't trust me, because I'm going to stab you in your back, all right, if I'm not following Torah. What keeps the blood or the relationship between you and I is that you can honestly, you would have to say, listen, you know what? Kasadaba is not going to take my wife. Kasadaba is going to be straight up with his wife. He's going to be loving and kind to all of the brothers because I know that he's going to follow Torah. That's why I love him, because he follows Torah. That's the only reason why. Not because the son of God can build a house. Because when I look at the scriptures, that's not a qualification to prove that I love Torah. Now, I'm not saying that, you know, you should learn how to live in a house. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm just trying to say that when we look at the scriptures now, what are the credentials that a person needs now in order to be in covenant relationship with the Father? 2 Samuel, the third chapter, verse 1 to 12.
Now, there was long war between the house of Shaul and the house of David.
I think that might be, let's try 1 Samuel. Let's just get it right quick. 1 Samuel. Make sure that I got this correct.
Perceived that the sovereign had called the child. Therefore, Eli said unto Samuel, go lie down, and it shall be, if he call thee, that thou shalt say, speak softly, for thou servant heareth.
So we now understand now that it wasn't
Eli.
It wasn't Eli that was calling him. It was actually now the father. Okay? We don't.
So Samuel went to lay down in his place.
Watch what's going to happen.
And the sovereign came and stood and called as at other times, Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel answered, speak, for thy servant hear. And the sovereign said to Samuel, behold, I will do a thing in Israel at which both the ears of everyone that hear it shall tingle.
What? Say that again.
And the sovereign said to Samuel, behold, I will do a thing in Israel.
I will do a thing in Israel,
at which both the ears of everyone that hear it shall tingle.
Hallelujah. Go ahead.
In that day I will perform against Eli all things which I have spoken concerning thy house.
So he has an issue with Eli. Read on.
When I begin, I will also make an end.
He's going to make an end of it too now, all right? Now we have now a father about to step in and handle the business. The man wasn't able to handle the business because of his personal feelings that was going on at this particular time. Listen, no problem. All right, daddy's home. You don't want daddy to come home and handle the situation. I guarantee you, none of us want that. As we used to say back in North, and I'm sure we said it down here too, you don't want that. You never want the father to step in and handle the situation. Read on.
For I have told him that I will judge his house forever.
I'm going to judge his house forever. Go ahead.
For the iniquity which he knoweth.
For the iniquity that he knoweth, you as the man of that house, and you know that there's iniquity or some misunderstanding in that house, and you don't correct it, the father said, I got you. Huh? You don't want the father to step in, I guarantee you, because the first time we saw that happen, it happened in the Garden of Eden. Okay? And when Adam didn't handle his responsibilities, guess what? Listen, both of you get your crap and get the heck up out of here. We're not having this here. Because in my father's house, we are all in one accord. Read on. Watch what's about to happen. Because Eli knew that there was a problem. Read on.
Because the sons made themselves vile, and he restrained them not.
Whoa! So he knew that his children was out of order, and he didn't restrain them. Read on.
And therefore I have sworn unto the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall be purged with sacrifice nor offering forever.
Will not be purged, right?
Will not, shall not be purged.
Shall, okay.
With sacrifice nor offering forever. And Samuel lay until the morning and opened the doors of the house of the sovereign. And Samuel feared to show Eli the vision. Then Eli called Samuel and said, Samuel, my son. And he answered, here am I. And he said, what is the thing that the sovereign has said unto thee? I pray thee, hide it not from me. Yahuwah do so to thee, and more also, if thou hide anything from me of all the things that he said unto thee. And Samuel told him every whit, and hid nothing from him. And he said, it is the sovereign. Let him do what seemeth him good. And Samuel ruled, and the sovereign was with him, and he did let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was established to be a prophet of the sovereign.
What verse you in now?
I'm at the last one, I'm 21 now.
You got 3 and 21?
Uh-huh.
Oh, my fault, like you wanted to stop at
15.
At 13. Yeah, my fault. What I wanted to show here, unless somebody is saying something totally different, we have talked about this for months, that the head of the house is actually the strength, the strong leader. He controls and watches over the house. Right? Now, hypothetically, if there was something going on in my house, and I knew that something was wrong, and I swept it underneath the rug. I know there's a problem. and I swept it underneath the rug as if it's not there. So every single day I'm getting up and I'm walking over this big lump that's in my carpet, and I know that there's an issue. Being that Eli, you know that there's an issue in your house, and you being the head or the olive of your house, and you didn't correct your problem, I'm going to judge you. You and your sons. All that I'm saying is make sure that you take care of your responsibilities. All right? Don't play games with the father, because you don't want to fall into the father's hands, where now he's going to say, listen, you know what? You can't handle it. I'll handle it. And the father is like a horticulturist. And this is a person that deals with plants. And we know that they're kind of rough. The father moves real rough. You ever seen a person that deals with plants? You know, they're not on tender. They're taking a plant out of the cup and they're not careful. It's a rough move. And being that, you know, we are rough people, you have to deal with rough people rough ways. You do. I mean, we're all stubborn people. It tells you that in the book of Ezekiel, I think like the fourth chapter. Mm-hmm. You know what? You know, their heads are hard as flint. Yes. All right. So I just wanted to end the class here. Just talking about, again, the topic. Oh, so there's no problem. There's no polygyny here. It's not here. I'm talking about making sure that everybody is prepared for a very important festival that's coming up. First, there is Yom Teruah. Yom Teruah is what? The announcement of the coming of the king. When you make the announcement of the coming of the king, you're supposed to not be preparing to meet the king. Because remember the parable about the brides. Only five were ready. What I'm trying to do, Maury is trying to do, and all of us are trying to do, is make sure that the bride is ready. This is what this class was about. We have Yom Teruah coming up, and then after Yom Teruah, now we have the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement now is that, listen, you're going to have to make sure if there's any issues with anybody, you have to make this pani-pani, face-to-face discussion on how I wronged you, get over it, and move on. That's how it works. You cannot get immersed, because I made a vow to Yahuwah. Whatever happened wrong with in my personal relationship or with anybody, I'm not bringing it up no more. It's done. It's a wrap. I made a vow in front of everybody here. It is done. I'm not bringing it up no more, because I believe through the blood of Yahusha HaMashiach that person's sins were redeemed. I was redeemed. Let's move on, because we get nowhere if you keep rehashing, bringing up the same thing over and over and over again. You now make the Torah a lie. And we can't have that. You have the Day of Atonement. Then after the Day of Atonement, you have the Feast of Sukkot. The Feast of Sukkot is when the groom and the bride are supposed to tabernacle together. That's the end gathering. And then after that, you have Shemini Atzeret. Okay, then that was the great day. This is now where now everything is done. We're finished. It's a wrap. And one more thing. What's so important about the seventh month, the tenth day, we're talking about a little bit, the seventh month, tenth day, is that the shofar is blown. The shofar is blown in the seventh month, the tenth day, making the announcement that the next year is the Jubilee year when your redemption takes place. That's what the whole thing means. This regard, I pray that we were able to get some understanding out of today's lesson. It was not about religion, please. It was about preparing for the Day of Atonement. I have it written here. It's in writing. So let's now work on more greater things. If there's any brother or sister in this congregation, if you want to be part of Sukkot, according to Scripture, it had to make amends with your brothers and sisters. Stand up. If there's any questions, we can stand up and pray.
Hallelujah.
Okay, so we're going to face the east. We're going to do the same thing. We're going to have shade to pray. We can tell the brothers to pray at the end, right?
All newcomers, please see Akote Shaya or Akote Cora to
to give your contact information, emails, phone number, etc., so that we can keep you current on the festivals of Yahuwah. And now I will bring up Sister Sadiqua for the new information on Sukkot. Toga.
Everything's good. Everything's told.
The person money that's coming out of my pocket, of Lamont, we're taking care of everybody's food. So that means now is that if 40 extra people come, they're going to want food to eat. But that's taken away from you. I would love to. This is our first time doing Sukkot, so we're asking everybody if you could just please be patient and work with us. Next year, we could probably do better, but we're not going to be able to feed every single body that's coming through because the numbers started to get crazy. I got a phone call this morning, about 9:42 this morning, where there's a couple that wants to come down. People are emailing us pictures of their checks. Please put us in. I mean, so it's getting, you just can't do it. But one more quick thing, if you saw the campsite, the reason why we have a cap on it, now you can get 60, maybe 70 people on the campsite, you can do that, but you can't set up 70 tents, because tents take up room. We have no more room. Yes.
Process should be on that campsite anyway. So, plus,
fire by day, the fire by night, the cloud by day. That's another lesson, but you know me, I'll get into another, but I'm going to keep it short. But that's what the whole thing was about, is following the instruction and the guidance and being under the covering of the Father. You know, when the feasts are cold, like you said, that was actually, your covering. But if Cameron, the clouds move, Israel moved, right?
I was looking at that. So if you want something special, I suggest you bring your snacks and your juices, your water, keep it in your tents, so that if that's what you want to do, then you can have it.
But if you decide to do those snacks, I suggest you put them in a container because the animals smell food.
Yeah.
At night. They move by night. I mean, so
I guess some very important information to bring out,
squirrels, things like that.
You got a question,
Sean? Oh, I just want to know, that camp passes out to everybody. I hope everybody got one. The camp,
on what we're doing as a family, not as an individual. This is a family thing. What we've been working on is trying to get on the TV show. We're there. But the problem is we're going to need everybody's participation. This is just not an individual thing. We were shooting for tomorrow. That's not going to happen. But we got next week to shoot on. We're going to be coming on at 8 o'clock, Channel 25. But this is just the plug-in where we're just going to be doing tapes. But we're going to do a live show. We've got to get with the guy at the end of this month. That's where we're going to need participation of everybody. Everybody needs to learn how to do this. Because if I can't be there, you can be there. I'm going to start off. This is my first time doing it. We got Brother Aaron, who went through all this. He knows how to do it. But he's working with us out of Florida, which is still good. All he can do is upload into the production area, and then you can bring them up. But the live class, we're going to need everybody's participation. Because we've got brothers now already signed up. I'm going to be a producer, but guess what? You need to learn how to be a producer as well. Everybody's going to know everybody's position. This is how this thing can work. Because what they have is something good. We need to put it out there. We need to let people know that we are here preaching this. And it's going to take everybody. And it's not our job, it's the Father's work we're doing, not ours. But thank to all the brothers that's already signed up, that's willing to work with us. We've got a squad so far first. It's going to take, I think, 3 or 4 people to do it. We're going to need a reel. Now, can sisters read you?
Yes.
I'm saying, you sisters can.
Yes.
But
you said Channel 25, is that Comcast?
It's Comcast. This is Comcast, yes. Now, of course, the. How far it's going to reach out? I think it reaches out to Atlanta, Conyers, and part of Grenada County. But what we're doing, we're going to establish one in Atlanta as well. It's called People's TV. That's going to be the live show. So we got to, if you're part of the live show, you got to show up an hour early to get everything going. If we don't show up, the show is not going on. And we've got a season. I think the season consists of 12 months. So we want to be able to show what we have to the world, to our community.
Now, when you say, what do you want people to, I mean, you need like a teleprompter, somebody
teleprompter,
to type in the scriptures?
People to run this camera, readers, it's a different position. I will get back with you and let you know what we need. So.
Okay, I've been bugging about the flyer. My hand on the flyer.
Because
that's a big part of, you know, putting stuff out here so people would know waiting on the flyer.
Salvi is putting that together. We will have the time of the show, the location. We will have emails, their emails, and we'll have a phone, live phone. We'll be able to answer the phone. We'll be able to direct the message to Salvi Eliyahu. Well, Casalva is putting flyers together.
This is the live show?
The live show will be got to find out the time slot. The time slot we have now is 8 o'clock, which is good. Football can't be over yet. So, brothers, you ain't got to worry about that. The live show, we're working on that. We're trying to get Wednesday, Tuesday, right, where it works with the side of our town being on. And we're shooting for like an 8 o'clock class as well.
So the recorded show is going to be on Sunday?
It's going to be now. The recorded show is going to be on Tuesday, because that's when the side of our town. We're shooting for that time.
Okay.
The show that's being taped will be on Sunday.
That's what I'm talking
about. Right. But the thing about this Sunday show is that, they don't have a building right now. That's why I say we need everybody's participation. When they get a building, guess what? We're live too on Sunday. But what we can do is that we may rotate live 1 week, tape the next week. Because we don't want to wear everybody out with two shows going on. But this is what we're doing. So, like I say, we're going to everybody participate. We can find a job for everybody. Don't say I can't. Yes, you can. This is new with me. I don't know how to build. Guess what? The Father's going to show me. Because this his will is being done, right, not mine. So I just want to keep you guys updated with what's going on. We was planning on having a show tomorrow, but technical difficulty, we're not going to have a show tomorrow. We will be next week.
Hallelujah.
That's all for now. We'll keep you posted, though. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Because everybody knows that we have Lori Eliyahu. He's ministering every... Yes, so he's been doing that, and him and I have, and with Rob, we've been alternating, so we're going to have to keep in contact, because we might need some assistance, but we're not might, we are going to need some assistance with the live show, where we're going to need you to actually to be live.
Still holding on to things, holding on to feelings. You know, situation happened a couple of years ago, and I'm not going to call their name, and a brother was offended by another brother. But instead of him going to that brother, he went to everybody outside of Israel. Mm-hmm. Now, after he gone to all these other people and amongst Israel, mm-hmm. but guess what? He never went to that brother. But then he wanted to come to me. By that time, my hands were tied because you didn't follow the Torah, follow the instruction on how we should handle things. So now you put me in a position, you tied my hands behind my back, so what am I supposed to do?
Yeah, you're right.
And so let's take upon ourselves, though, let's do not go out of here the way we came in. If we know there's something bothering us, let's make it right. So first of all, I guarantee one thing, within your mind, you told yourself, I'm going to wake up in the morning. You're not even guaranteed to go out that door and make it home. So if you still carry these things, you still have these things in your heart, you can't head into the judge. You're right. So these things hinder and clutter up and just keep the favor of the Most High from flowing in your life. But he's not going to operate in confusion. That's just not going to be there. Because if there's confusion, there's no akkad. And so let's keep these things in mind. And first of all, while we're talking about offended, let me get this to y'all can see me.
I said,
first of all, yeah, you're right. Because I'm finna apologize because my actions last week were not appropriate. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, you're okay.
And I want this entire congregation and an apology. And I want y'all to know I'm sorry for my actions and the way I handled my anger and things. Because we have to make things right. Because one thing I always want to keep in mind, y'all don't belong to me. Y'all don't belong to Messiah. Y'all belong to Yahuwah. You're his people.
That's right.
And so I have to be careful how I handle you because you're not mine, you're his. And so I just want to ask y'all, let every last one of y'all know, I'm sorry, I was wrong, and I ask for your forgiveness. Ain't no ands, ifs, buts about it. I was wrong.
Goodness.
Mm-hmm.
We love you, man.
Yes.
Absolutely.
We love you,
Maureen.
Okay.
Hey, I love you like a piece of cake.
Yeah.